Welcome to the Barker Podcast Collection.
I've paid my dues time after time. I've done my sentence but committed no crime. And bad mistakes I've made a few. I've had my shells and kicked in my face, but I've come through.
And I need to go on, 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 on.
Welcome to the Not Watching Podcast. My name's Rob Howard, and today I'm joined by
Marcus Hurley.
So yeah, we finally get to it. After 6 years or so, we've reached episode 200 of the Not Watching Podcast.
Amazing.
Yeah, so we thought we'd do something a bit different and
we not
cast our minds back
in there or something. I don't know.
Maybe rough. I can find a suitable tune to kick the show off with. Yeah, I'll find a fanfare-y intro tune to start off with. But anyway, yeah, so we thought we'd do something a bit different and cast our minds back to October 2013 and onwards from there, because that's kind of about when we started. When we started this podcast, interesting fact, this is before your time, Marcus, not by that long, but when I started it with Ian and John, we were just talking about TV. So, yeah, we didn't talk about movies at all. So, yeah, but that's the way things have kind of morphed into. And, yeah, so even though we weren't talking about movies back then, we're still going to cast our minds back to then and just, yeah, kind of go through our favourite movies and TV since October 2013. So let's get the ball rolling with movies then. And, yeah, do you want to kick off, Marcus?
Okay, for me, might as well start off strong. Movies. Okay.
Yep.
Logan, 2017.
Good pick. I didn't pick it. It was in the list, but it fell off. But no, I'm glad you mentioned it. It's a very significant movie, I just
thought it was so good. With, like, even now, I mean, even compared to all of the X-Men films, and I really liked First Class, and I really liked Days of Future Past, especially, actually, the Rogue Cut of Days of Future Past, which is the definitive version, by the way. I really like those films, but I just thought Logan was just such a better film.
It's definitely one of the stronger X-Men movies.
And I just, yeah, I've not seen it in a long while, but the fact that I still, even just the name, and it evokes that feeling of, yeah, that was a goddamn good film.
Yeah.
So, yeah, yeah, it's got to be in there.
Cool. Okay. Well, yeah, my first one is Split. And it's just because I couldn't lose it off my shortlist because of the way it made me feel in the cinema.
Yeah.
I've never really had that sort of mind-blowing. I mean, I've seen twists in movies before. I saw The Sixth Sense in the cinema, you know, the first week it came out. I knew nothing about what that was going to be about. And yeah, that blew my mind. But yeah, Split was
right
it was
at the
such
end
a,
of the film, and you're like, "What?"
Yeah, yeah. just oh my god, this is part of that universe. I mean, since then, it's not kind of gone so well, apparently. But I still haven't seen Glass. But you know, I'm just going to bask in the glory of Split for now.
No. Split's a great film. It still is.
Yeah,
I've seen it since the cinema. It's still an amazing film.
Yeah, McAvoy's like performance
so
is
good.
Just
so good.
It's just epic, yeah. Yeah, 2 years ago, Logan was, according to our episode on it that I've got here. I don't know what point you started doing this with us. So
A little while back.
Were you on that one or not?
I'll have
to go back and listen.
Yeah. I've been doing this a while, I think. Good few years.
Yeah.
I think I might have started probably around 2013, tail end of it, I reckon.
Yeah, I'll have to. Yeah, I think you definitely did like Mad Max and stuff with this.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I can look back through my archives.
Yeah. What you got next then?
Okay, next for me is John Wick.
The first John Wick.
Yeah.
And another very significant movie.
I've actually got all three on here in the listing, but if I was to pick all three, yeah, I'd say the first one because it's that impact.
Yeah.
It's watching this film and thinking, this film feels like I'm watching something not filmed now, but filmed in like the late 80s, early 90s, but with the stylistic filmography of today.
Yeah.
And just the feel of it, it's like storytelling of an action era that's kind of gone now.
Yeah.
And just brought back. And Keanu Reeves is absolutely perfect for the role. Yeah, God, I just don't. I mean, I'm seeing people now saying, I've not seen John Wick. And I'm like, what are you doing with your life? And then they watch it and they go, why have I not seen this film before? It's amazing. And I'm like, well, I've been telling you to go watch it for like, since 2014.
Yeah, I mean, it kind of came out of nowhere.
Yeah.
Oh, no. And I didn't know about it enough to like go and see it at the cinema. God, I don't even know if they showed it around here.
I watched it on a, I think I watched it on a rental or something, yeah. One of those rental ones. And I was just like, you need to see this film. And I showed it to her. So I was like, yeah, you need to. She's like, it's Keanu Reeves action film. Yeah, it might be okay. Like, no. You really need to see this film. And now we're both massive diehard fans of the series.
Yeah.
And we're seeing all of them like together. It's just so good. Ridiculous.
Yeah, no, and it's going to continue and grow that franchise. So yeah, it has to be mentioned just for the fact that it's, like a few of things that I'm probably going to mention on here, you know, it's a significant franchise that has, you know, we've been talking about throughout the whole length of this show being on air, you know. Yeah. So, yeah, so my next one is Mad Max Fury Road.
Oh, I left that off. That was a great film.
Yeah.
Only because I just didn't remember it. But to be honest, not including any of these in our list doesn't mean that we look down on these films. It just means there are too many and we just be sitting here spouting films off.
Yeah, I mean, you know what I did? I just sort of looked at like what I thought my movie of the year was. I sort of went through, because on some of the episodes,
yeah,
I actually mentioned and it reminded me what I had as my movie of the year, so that kind of cut a lot of it off.
Yeah.
Sort of narrowed it down for me. But yeah, Mad Max Fury Road was like way better than it had any reasonable need to be. It was just a triumph of filmmaking, a very simplistic story.
We went and watched that together, didn't we? I think we were a group of us went to watch it, yeah.
Yeah, man, I think
that was
so,
insane.
Yeah.
What was his name? The guy with the guitar. He had a name. It's like Dude Slayer or something weird like that. I don't know. It was like the Dude Rider.
Yeah, I can't remember.
And it's the flaming guitar and the fact that he's actually playing the theme as all of this is happening. Because the bit where he jumps off and to avoid being attacked, and the music stops, and then he carries on, and it's like, fuck.
Yeah, it's awesome. It makes me want to watch it again.
Yeah, no, I've not seen it in a while. Yeah. Making me want to.
So what you got next?
Right, for me, I've got to go Ready Player One.
Ah, yes.
I know these are fairly recent films, but doesn't mean they're not good. Ready Player One, I just love it. It's a massive geek fest. Tugs on the heartstrings of when I used to be a big hardcore MMO gamer, and just meeting up with friends in the arcades and stuff, all of that sort of almost like a whole lifetime ago and stuff. It's, and also just like geeking out with you and other mates, just the way that we are and talking about references and everything else, and the way that they are together just talking about things, almost like how we are in this podcast, and we'll drop bits in as well. I just thought it was so good. I mean, it might have changed from the books, it doesn't matter. For me, the experience of seeing that film, going to see that film three times in a row, and the only reason why I haven't watched it again is because I just thought I'm going to save it up a little bit and then I'm going to watch it again. So now I kind of need to.
Yeah, I had a really unfortunate experience trying to watch that film where like I went in the wrong screen.
Yeah.
So I missed like the first sort of 20 minutes of it.
Yeah.
And then I kind of I went into the right screen and then I had to wait like 3 months to watch the first 20 minutes of it again.
Yeah.
So I've sort of I've sort of had a bit of a weird sort of experience with that, but I did like what they did with it. I like that they didn't completely replicate the film, the book, sorry.
Yeah.
You know, they sort of used the film as an opportunity to explore more of the Oasis, and I really appreciated that.
I just loved the Spielberg-esque story of it. I thought it reminded me, without it being set in the 80s, a lot of the references, like the Akira bike and the DeLorean and everything else, and King Kong, and then the Jurassic Park references from the 90s, and Superman, and all this sort of stuff, and Godzilla, Mechagodzilla, and Iron Giant, Gundam. It was just ridiculous, all wrapped up in a Spielberg-style story. Fantastic.
Yeah, I think I need to give that another look, to be honest.
I just thought it was so... I was glad the story wasn't an arse-ache, because with all of the shit going on and all of the stuff, the story wasn't bland, but it wasn't too twisty and too mental. I just thought it was perfect for the delivery system of all of that.
Yeah, it was really, really cool. Okay, my next one is Arrival, which is the film directed by Denis Villeneuve, who's currently went on to do Blade Runner and is now doing Dune. Very talented sci-fi director. I thought this was really good because of the way that it looked at sci-fi as like and the communication. It looked at the understanding of another extraterrestrial species that doesn't think of things in the same linear way that we do, the way that time is just a different construct.
Because it
looks at the fundamental fact that humans are storytellers. You know, mm-hmm. everything that we use to define the universe and describe, quantify reality is done in a very specific way to us, and that there are other ways to understand that. And so the structure of the film is itself kind of folds in on itself, and you know, you think it's building up to something, and it's got an awesome twist in it. I think it's one of the very best films I've seen in the time that I've been doing this podcast, so that's why I mention it now. What you got next?
Here's where it gets difficult. I'm just going to throw one out there because it's on there. Bohemian Rhapsody.
Cool.
I just thought, as a biopic goes, it wasn't warts and all, but it wasn't meant to be. It was meant to be a story, and it contained just enough darkness, just enough light, and enough flamboyance to feel like a Queen biopic. Excluding the Live Aid sort of bit at the end, which just absolutely wrenches at you. Because that's kind of like, that's almost like a stinger at the end, and you kind of go, whoop, what the hell? But I thought the film was really well handled. Rami Malek's performance was amazing. I thought the way that they did it, the way that we finally learned that Bohemian Rhapsody was just a bunch of batshit stuff that they put together to try and make the most flamboyant, over the top, insane, lunatic record they could, and it is. And little bits like Bismillah, and you think, what the hell's that? And you realise it's the name that his mother calls him by. And I think it means, I can't remember what it meant in the film, but it's what she calls him. And it's like, let me go. And you kind of think, it's like talking almost like, you know, to the parents. It's like, almost like your mother's calling. He's like, no, let me go do my thing, or not. And it's not really meaning. And I just love the fact that you've got an answer, that the song was just bonkers. And I was like, I love that. And there's all of it, just all of it. All the songs, just like a nice little film, because it's fucking huge. But I left that cinema just almost tearing up. And as one of cinema experiences go, I think it was one of my best. So I have to put it on there. We could list other ones, but I just think it was fantastic. Such a good film. And yeah, I definitely thought it was brilliant. Couldn't watch it loads of times, but yeah, awesome.
Yeah, doesn't the Blu-ray have like a few more minutes on it or something?
I think the Blu-ray's got more. I think it's got like an extended cut of the Live Aid thing as well. Because they filmed shitloads more for that, I think. I think it's got more in it, much more. And there's like a different version as well, I think.
Yeah, I know that they said that they were going to put that on the Blu-ray, but I never got round to actually checking it out.
I think there's two versions or something. I don't know what the difference is. Might have to look into it. But awesome, awesome film.
Yeah. Now, I've got a lot of time for it. I was very excited to see it. I ended up seeing it twice in the cinema. I think it was my movie of the year last year. Just because I've just grown up with, that band. And it says on the Amazon box, it says experience the full Live Aid film performance not seen in cinemas.
Jesus.
So it must be like a slightly extended cut. It might be an extra thing that they've put on the Blu-ray. I might have to actually add that on my wish list, actually. Oh, it's actually in the, it's actually deal of the day.
Ugh.
Right now for £11.
I'm scared.
I might just click it. Yes, so am I, but I don't know. Maybe. Let's see how I feel after this recording. So my next one is Star Wars The Force Awakens.
I've got that as well.
Yeah. I would hope so.
Yeah.
It was kind of a major milestone, I think. You could probably chart our entire another film I'm probably going to mention, or you are in a minute, you can kind of chart the whole conversation of this podcast is kind of the build up to that film coming out.
Yeah.
and the subsequent sequels, the next one we're about to get. The whole sort of reinvention of Star Wars is a big reason that this podcast has kind of been going. It's given us so much fuel. Back when we were talking about news every week,
yep.
You know, there would always be like the latest thing on what was happening with Star Wars, who'd been cast. We haven't been doing that so much lately, but it was a big...
I remember when Ian was sort of... big love to you,
who?
Mate. When he was in tears knowing that J.J. Abrams had built the sets for the Millennium Falcon, they weren't using digital sets.
Everything
was being built, and we were like, shit. And it showed. It really did. I remember us leaving the cinema after all watching it.
It was just shell-shocked.
Yeah, you, me and John, and we just sat down on the curb outside. It was just like rubbing our temples, going, I was sitting there going, my head's spinning. I just don't know. Can we go back and watch it again?
Like, I know, man. Like, yeah, it was crazy.
It was fantastic. I just left that cinema like... It's like being on a roller coaster, and literally you get off and you're like, I need to catch my breath now.
It was awesome.
What a welcome back.
It was really good. I think, you know, even though a lot of people, you know, in this distance from it, you can kind of say, you know, he was definitely hitting a lot of the boxes from A New Hope.
Yeah, but...
You can lay that at it.
But, my God... Getting to see an alternative version of kind of like New Hope with the filming special effects and technology of now, like seeing the Falcon with the way we do effects now, lightsaber battles, it was just glorious. It was mental. I mean, that was my initial thing going into it. I was like, I get to see without all of the bullshit, all of the politics of the prequels, because it was about like the Senate and all that crap. It was just a Star Wars film, probably more action with special effects as they moved on even further. And it was just.
Yeah.
It still awesome. Is. I mean, I look back now and I just think, I jokingly was going to put the trailer for Force Awakens as my favourite film of the year, but
oh god,
do you remember
that.
The debacle of that? Oh, that was a fun podcast. but just, I think that was just because it hit me so hard, and I still think as pieces go, that is whoever's got that on their CV. God, they're going to go far. But anyway, great film. Let's crack on.
Okay. All right. So So yeah, I've done Star Wars: Force Awakens. What's your next one?
It's getting more difficult now. So obviously there are some Marvel films in here.
Yeah, well, yeah, I'm kind of going that way next myself.
Okay, so, this is brutal. Okay, this is not order of preference, so I'm going to go with Captain America, The Winter Soldier.
Okay, so what, you're picking that as your one?
No. I don't know. I'm just thinking, not out of all of the Marvel ones, because I don't know if I can fucking choose.
Does this just turn into a Marvel, like, splurge fest
this
now?
There's a few others on there. Well, there's a few. But, okay. You know what? It's got to be Infinity War.
Well, that's the only other one I was going to mention.
Infinity War. I'll say Infinity War, because Infinity War was the culmination of all of it, and they had to pull off Infinity War, because Endgame, being a great film, but Endgame can only exist if Infinity War works.
And interestingly,
Infinity War worked.
Interestingly, they came up with Endgame before Infinity War.
Yeah.
Infinity War was just designed to get another Avengers film to get them all to the point of Endgame.
Yeah.
So,
but
it needed to work.
Because if... Yeah. Endgame didn't work. I mean, if Infinity War didn't work in cinemas, people would go, oh, the ending's shit. I don't know if I'll bother with Endgame.
Yeah, yeah.
But...
Yeah, because... Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah, because you ended up with, like... Yeah, that's why it was so genius, I thought. Some people have a problem with this, but I just like that they managed to do that incredible juggling act of combining all these different franchises all at the same time. And just the effect was just incredible, because you were just hanging out with all these cool characters that you've come to love over the last 10 years, and it all kind of made sense, kind of.
I still don't understand how they managed to share screen time with everyone without it feeling like it was someone's film. If anything, it was Thanos' film, but...
Thanos doesn't
get all the screen time, because you have the Black Order and everything else and stuff. It's like one of those pie charts, and it's all divided up almost equally in a weird way.
Yeah.
It's such an achievement after all of those films. That's why I had to put it on there, because it's insane. Like that moment when I turned to you and it's like, that's Thanos, and I went, eep! And then I spent like 20 minutes talking at you, which you're probably thinking, what the fuck is this guy on about? And I'm like, they're doing the Infinity War, they're doing the Infinity Gauntlet, they're doing the Infinity Stones. I'm like, Jesus, man.
I don't think you were doing that. I would have punched you if you were going to talk at me for that long in a film.
No. Not. I mean, like, at the end, it was the stinger at the end, and I was like, that's Thanos. Right. It's fucking Thanos. They're doing it. They're fucking doing it. I can't believe it. I don't think I spoiled it. I didn't spoil it for you, but I went, if they're doing what I think they're doing, we're all going to be very happy. And lo and behold, we were. Fuck.
Yeah, I mean, I'd sort of heard about that because a mate of mine who I used to work with, he lent me the Infinity War comic, and I've read it, you know. Mm. I didn't know it was going to go exactly that way, and it's almost in a different context when it's like in the movies and the MCU. It's very different to the comics and stuff. But,
it was good.
I think Infinity War like definitely represents like the MCU when it was kind of at its highest. I know Endgame's the same, but Endgame's kind of got quite a lot of melancholy attached to it. It starts off at a pretty low point and it ends at kind of a low point because it's the end and, you know, we have to say goodbye to a few people and it feels like a bit more, you know, it's...
Endgame's alternative name could have been Swan Song.
Yeah, it is. Right.
It's the end of that whole... Because I noticed when I'm going to watch Spider-Man, you had the ticker from Marvel, the one where it showed all of the different ones, but the Marvel Studios bit no longer had the 10-year bit on it.
Yeah.
Well, so that black, phase is now over. Because all of the last films had that, where the I and the O of Marvel became a 10.
Well, they did in the last year or so, because it was 10 years of Marvel.
That's now done.
Yeah, it's definitely the end of an era. And I mean, you know, we're having that with Star Wars as well. And it's kind of part of the reason that I'm going to make an announcement at the end of this episode. So it's all kind of tied into that, really. But anyway, we'll get to that. So yeah, you've got a load more movies, have you? You want to mention?
I've got a few.
I'm done.
You're done. Okay. Well, I could say honourable mentions. Okay. Obviously, I had the whole of the John Wick trilogy on there because I can't decide anything. You've known me long enough. I got Godzilla King of the Monsters on there because I was so impressed of a Western version of an Eastern film, and that threw me for a loop. So that's got up there one of my favourites so far, just because of the achievement of what it did. Not box office, but in terms of actual putting it together and creating something that shouldn't really exist.
That doesn't matter. No, it's cool.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Spider-Man Homecoming, because they've created a Spider-Man film that was different from all of the others. And
see, I'm...
Yeah, go for it.
I just made myself choose one MCU film.
Yeah. But Spider-Man Homecoming, for me, was like, oh, it's a different Spidey, different world, different Aunt May, and it was nice, and that's why I went to see more.
And he's in the MCU, so that's an achievement in itself, really.
Avengers Infinity War, obviously, and Endgame, because Endgame, they go part and parcel.
I nearly just put them both down,
I had Blade Runner 2049 in there, because watching that film back-to-back with the original, the final cut version, fuck me, those films sit nicely next to each other. It's ridiculous. Like, following one from the other, it feels like you're reading two books that are literally following one.
It's not one that I'd think to do, though, because they're set so far apart.
I know, but that's the problem. That's the thing. It's like you think because of the age of the film, but because I'd watched one and literally ran to the cinema to watch the new one, it felt like...
Yeah,
it was,
you're just associated
like,
with that.
It was like, oh, he's found him after years. It was almost like you have a fade out and it says 30 years later or whatever. It felt like that.
So yeah, I enjoyed it, but I've not really felt the need to get it on Blu-ray or watch it again for some reason. Maybe if it comes on again on Netflix, I might give that another look.
Yeah. I had Upgrade as well on there because it's a quirky little film, but I just loved it as a kind of science film. Upgrade. It didn't really get a massive release. It was the one where the guy gets a chip in his head.
Yeah, I know.
Yep. Okay, cool. Yeah.
Yeah, I enjoyed it.
And also on the slightly smaller scale one, Life, with Jake Gyllenhaal, Ryan Reynolds.
Oh, yeah, the one with the...
The little creature that they find in the spaceship, and it all goes horribly wrong. I loved that film. I just loved the way it went. I loved the way that it was just unforgivingly merciless.
I thought it was all right. It was quite like
an out-of-limits-y type film, isn't it? It was like a sort of... Twilight Zone-y sort of film.
Yeah, okay.
But I just loved it. The fact that they didn't pull any punches and there was no happy ending. Spoiler.
Fair.
Yeah, and obviously Captain America Winter Soldier and Captain America Civil War.
Cool, yeah.
I couldn't whittle that list down anymore, but I got through and mentioned the bullet points, and those are the ones that were sitting behind.
No, I think you did pretty well there.
Considering from 2013...
yeah.
There's probably a few I had missed off. But... Anyway.
Oh, Mad Max is Black and Chrome is going for £8 at the moment.
Can you just get Fury Road and turn the colour off?
I don't know. I don't know if my TV does black and white.
It should do.
Yeah, I think I'd need to dig into the setting somewhere.
Just pick one of the TV settings you don't use, like movie or whatever. And then just copy the settings from like your default one, but just have the colour off.
Yeah.
That's what I end up doing with some of them. I just fiddle around with them.
I don't think it's quite as simple as that. I think they've done a bit of correction and
things to
get it working in a certain way.
I was just being a bit of a cheapskate.
Okay. All right. So that's some of our favourite movies over the last six or whatever it is years. Yeah. We're going to move into some TV now.
God.
Okay, I think I'm going to go first here. Okay, so again, I've taken the same thing. I've just got five.
Okay,
and I've had to narrow it down quite a bit. So the first one I'm going to mention is Daredevil, the first season of Daredevil, specifically, just because I think it was kind of it was it was so exciting what they were doing with Marvel. You know, there was this exciting new partnership between Netflix and Marvel. They're going to make these really edgy, grown-up versions of the of Marvel heroes, and they were going to combine into this amazing Defenders supergroup, and it was all going to be amazing. And we're going to love every single episode, and none of the seasons would be too long. We'd want more, you know, they'd leave us wanting more. It was an exciting new time, cutting edge filming. And I just love that feeling that that whole show represented and actually delivered on for that one season.
Yeah.
It wasn't all bad.
No.
And it was an ambitious idea. The second season, I don't think, was as good, but introduced us to the Punisher, who was probably, you know, the secret, unexpected part of that.
I still think season two, the first half, was good, was worthy.
Yeah.
I think it went wayward after that, but...
Yeah, I mean, it's all a bit of a blur for me now, yeah. But I just remember that first season of Daredevil with Kingpin being, and that just being so good. And like a slow burn, you know, he didn't get the suit until quite late on. And yeah, I just really enjoyed that. And, you know, and Jessica Jones was okay. Iron Fist can get fucked.
Yeah, Luke Cage was a letdown.
First season of Luke Cage was okay.
First I half thought. Of the first season
yeah,
was
Yeah, first
Luke
half,
Cage.
Yeah, that's fair, that's fair.
I think when he went off and then he, when they left the city and he had the little nod to the iconic version of him, with the little metal circlet, when it flashed back to him coming out of the bath. That was cool. But then when they came back and then he was just... It was almost like Rocky V where they're just fighting in the street and I'm like, this is the finale. Jesus.
Yeah. Even the Defenders was a bit of a wet squib. I thought,
I've forgotten about
damn
that.
Squib.
That doesn't
exist. I barely remember it. I think it was
past it when I see it on Netflix. Probably won't see it on there for long.
Well, it was weird as well because they sort of did that and then they kind of just carried on making... The other shows, like...
Well, Defenders to me felt like Daredevil season 2.5 with guest stars.
Yeah.
Because none of the other people really kind of... I mean, or actually, it was like Daredevil season 2, the second half, smashed together with Iron Fist.
Yeah.
And which was not appealing. That whole hand storyline, I couldn't care less. And which is why the Electra arc, and I was a bit like, they kind of could have done it in a condensed way, but he just took over everything and it wasn't enjoyable.
But in my opinion, first season of Daredevil
was awesome.
Was good and was worth putting on this list. Yep. So yeah.
And the third season redeemed itself a bit.
Yeah. Did you write down any of these for yours?
I had Jessica Jones season 1. I still think, weirdly, I prefer it to Daredevil first season. It just pips it for me because I loved the fact that she was a PI and she was this disgruntled character, and there were nods to the fact that she was a superhero, gave it a go but didn't give a shit. And you can see the costume and stuff like that, and you had nods to Patsy becoming Hellcat because of that policeman, and she's like, she gets hyped up on the drug. And it's like, oh, you see it in her and stuff, and she's wanting to defend herself after things happen. Like, the guy breaks into her place, and she gets the panic door set up and all that sort of thing. And it's just, I thought it was so well done. And not even, and on top of all of that, you had David Tennant as the bad guy. So even without him, I just found it much more enjoyable because it was a darker, seedier world because she's a PI, and it was just a bit brutal and very violent. You know, people were stabbing themselves and all that sort of thing, throwing themselves off buildings because he told them to. And you had all the characters. You had I think you had Claire the nurse show up, I'm not sure, but you had
she popped up in all of them, I think.
And you had what's her name, the lawyer from Daredevil, can't remember her name, should know her name because I've just watched
Trinity from the Matrix,
Carrie Ann Moss's character, with her in there as the lawyer and the relationship they have. And I just found it a really nice place to be. And season 2 for that kind of dropped off a bit. But I really enjoyed this last season. I thought
all the stuff with her mother was just...
Yeah,
like,
I thought it didn't need to go on that long. It really didn't. But the third season I've really enjoyed, and it's felt like a back to form for me, and a nice way to send off the character. And the ending of it was fantastic, because you just don't know. Don't know if you've seen it yet, but...
No, I haven't watched any of it yet.
Yeah, no, the third season is good. It's back to kind of like her doing PI stuff, and yeah, stuff going on. Yeah, no, it's definitely worth a watch. I still haven't finished Punisher, and I don't know if I'll finish it. I'm slowly watching an episode every couple of months.
I can't do that.
I'm watching an episode.
Every couple of months, God. I mean...
I can't be arsed, and every time I watch it, I'm reminded why. I watch one episode, and I think, there are so many other things I could be watching, and then I skip to that.
And you still don't watch Black Mirror?
I haven't got around to it. I've downloaded it on my phone. Yeah. So I will get around to it eventually.
Is it because they're like just one-offs, so you just like
Black Mirror? No. Yeah. I've been starting to watch Black Mirror. I've started at the beginning because I caught the Christmas, White Christmas one, the three episodes that were all linked. I caught that and that intrigued me. So I've seen the first season of it. And I think I started, I might be on the last episode of the first season or the second episode of the second season. The seasons are so short. So I've been watching them, but it's just getting back round after watching everything else as well. It's just that time, because I can't just chuck it on. And I don't really have a commute anymore. So it's like, you know.
Yeah, that's true. That takes away a lot.
If I had a commute,
then
that's it. I've got a 10-minute bus journey. That's it.
Yeah, see, I did a little cheeky segue there, because I was going to mention Black Mirror next anyway.
Yeah, nice.
That's definitely on my list. I keep coming back to it. I don't think the latest season's been particularly strong, but it's really just they're all just so different, and they cover such a wide range of things. They've even predicted like the future in some ways. The very first episode, in fact, was a bit close to the bone. Okay. But since then, we've had all kinds of like, we're going into all these sort of the way that we have all this security, and you know, everyone's observed and everything's documented and rated, and you know, all this social media madness, like that's a real thing pretty much. And yeah, he's still got a really really observant and good kind of view on what's happening, I think, that's entertaining as much as it is scary. And also, we've had the Bandersnatch interactive episode, which was like just like no other bit of TV I've ever seen. Have you done that?
Oh yeah, yeah. First sitting, me and Sue sat there for about 3.5-4 hours.
So you have watched Black Mirror?
Oh yeah, yeah. I've seen nearly two seasons of it, mate.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We did that. We tried looking for so many endings. I was after when I managed to get the boss to come round instead of Colin.
and you end up killing him. The first time I think I did it, went through, and it was like an hour and a half I did it for, and then I was like, no, I've done it wrong. And so I went back and spent the rest of the evening playing it, just doing all the different, trying to get all the different endings.
We were there for like good 3-4 hours with the first sitting, going round and round. Yeah. And then I think the next day we did another 3 hours of it, just trying to find different ones. And then every spare moment we were putting it on going, can we find a different one? Just going through. That was fun. That was good.
Yeah, that was a nice little Christmas treat I found. Cool. What you got next?
There's some heavy hitters in my list, but they're kind of obvious, so I'm going to go for one that's slightly less. Altered Carbon.
Oh, man, yeah. Why is that not on my list?
Because my list has probably got... My list has 12 things on there.
I don't understand why that didn't make my list. That's like one of the best things
I've
ever seen.
Because your list has not got 12 things on there.
No, it definitely hasn't. That's why, yeah, you can help me out here, because mine are just pretty obvious, really. But yeah, Old Carbon is excellent.
I've left the two obvious ones out. They're like the first ones on there for me as well.
Yeah, I've got a couple.
Altered Carbon. I thought that was awesome. I thought it was so good. So good. Almost like a nice merger of Blade Runner, Battle Angel and Alita, Ghost in the Shell. A lot of 90s cyberpunk sort of stuff I used to read in comics.
So cyberpunk.
It was just thrown together and I was just like, I'm loving this.
I prefer it to Blade Runner, if I'm honest with you.
It's more action-oriented Blade Runner. That's pretty much what it would be. It takes its cues well.
Yeah, it's awesome. I'm waiting for there to be like a little gap in my schedule so I can watch it again.
I just love the Highlander, random Highlander reference. Like the sort when they're having the sword fight at the end, him and, I won't spoil it because people are watching it, but the end part, they're having a sword fight, and the sword he picks up is the MacLeod sword from Highlander.
Oh, I remember you saying about this.
Which is a nice touch because it kind of, the whole program is basically a form of immortality, isn't it? You're immortal in those discs.
Yeah.
So I thought that was such a weird, nice way of going on about that. And then you kind of think, oh, he's got that. And it's like, oh, and then it made me think, oh, if they ever did a reboot, he'd be great for the Duncan MacLeod character.
Oh, yeah.
But anyway, yeah, no, that was a great show.
Cool, yeah, I can't believe I didn't mention that. I loved it to bits. my favourite kind of show that has like a beginning, middle and end and maybe, you know, could be a standalone. They are making another one, though, I think.
But it could quite easily have just stopped there. That's the thing.
Yeah. It was almost like that's just too much awesomeness. Like, I don't need any more. It's fine. I'll just watch it again. my next one is Halt and Catch Fire, which I think was my TV show of the year that it came out. I was very late to it. I think I caught it just as the final season was airing. I saw they had it all on Amazon Prime, so I just binged it in a couple of weeks. And it basically charted the rise of a fictitious computer company in the 80s and kind of went from sort of the boom of the old Apple to the beginning of the internet and sort of followed these four very strong characters and their trials and stuff and relationships throughout four seasons, each of which sort of took a particular focus on a different part of that. You know, they start off, they're building computers, then they move into like programming online games, bulletin boards, and then it sort of evolves into like what we sort of the early days of the internet when it was being manually curated and people like made lists of things manually rather than there being search engines like Google that serve us what we want. Yeah, it's really cool. I loved it. I'll still recommend it to anyone. And I was a mess in the final season. It was so sad.
I remember you saying that you were really taken for it. I remember your messages and stuff popping up.
It was so good. So good. That's my third one. Still rate it really highly. What you got next?
Right. That's the thing, they're so bloody different. That's what really annoys me about my list. It's why I couldn't whittle it down, because they all tug on certain things. But I'm going to say Haunting of Hill House.
Oh, yeah, another great one. Because another fantastic one.
As horror kind of series go, man, that was good. Character and story driven, and all of the sort of creepiness and stuff set to basically unsettle you. It was...
Yeah.
It had jump scares, it had scares and creepiness and just fucking horror. But it was just the story of the family. It was almost like a weird, fucked up version of like something like The Shining and stuff, like the story of the hotel or something. It was just weird, but it wasn't necessarily about the building. It was about the family, but also the building. And it was just, I don't know, the way it ended as well, which is why I said it reminded me a bit like The Shining.
It was about that the characters were haunted.
Yeah.
Yeah. By their past.
Yeah.
As well as the building itself
being haunted. And the
house is almost like a metaphor for how fucked up the kids have grown up.
It was just so good. And the flashback. So you had all of the proper creepy, scary bits back then. And some of the plot twists in it were so good.
Yeah, I was on the train when one of those happened.
The bent neck lady.
That was so good. So expertly done.
I just couldn't believe it. And it's just, oh, man. Apparently, there's so much. I mean, when we went away, like, for a weekend, a friend of ours had some woodland, so we all went away. I got recommended to watch it by Suze while I was there. I'm glad I didn't. But she watched it, and then when we came back, we watched it again. So literally in the space of like a couple of days, she'd seen it twice. So she already knew what was happening, and she enjoyed it, watching the entire series twice over. And also seeing all of the things in the background, she spotted more. She didn't tell me. There's so much in like the background and stuff that you don't notice, apparently.
Oh, yeah, there's, like, loads of ghosts.
Yeah.
There's, like, a guy that's, like, fixing a clock.
Yeah, I think that's one of the obvious ones, like...
Yeah.
I think ones that they give it away by clothing or something like that, and you just think that people are, like, doing repairs around the house, but then if you actually bother to look at what they're wearing, you kind of go,
they're not interacting with them at all.
Like, they're just there, or they don't see them, and maybe we see them. We don't know. That's what I loved about it. I thought... It wasn't an out-and-out horror. It was just a horror story.
Freaking me out now, talking about it. It's freaking me out. What's that noise? Yeah, I'm freaking out now. Maybe we should move on.
Yeah, let's move on.
Yeah. No, that was excellent. But they are... Mike Flanagan, though, who directed and wrote all of that, he's making has made the sequel to The Shining, Dr. Glass.
Oh, wow.
Which is out later in the year.
Nice.
What's his name? Trainspotting. Ewan McGregor. Mm. He's playing grown-up Danny Torrance.
Oh, sweet.
And this is a book that Stephen King wrote. But what they're doing... Because Stephen King was never a big fan of The Shining, the film. He said that he made it... he said there was no character development because the way Jack Nicholson played him, it's like he was already mad when he got there, and in the film it was more of like he wanted the house to be the thing that made him mad, and that's how he wrote the book, and so he couldn't get on with that. I listened to an interview with him on this awesome Eli Roth History of Horror podcast. Very, very much recommend that if you're into hearing people talking about stuff they've done. So they're doing a second season of Haunting of Hill House.
Yeah, I've heard. It's different characters, different setting. Almost a bit like American Horror Show, Horror Story.
Yeah, it's like a lot of the same actors, but playing different characters. It's based on this Haunting of Bly Manor. I think that's what it's going to be called. And that's like a pretty famous ghost story, apparently. But I've never read it. Cool. Okay. So yeah, let's pull out the big guns now. I've got Game of Thrones next.
Yeah, might as well go over that.
Yeah. So obviously, this just wrapped up with a final controversial season. We already talked about it.
Yeah.
Ad nauseum, pretty much.
To be honest, having enough breathing room now. I got to say, it was bloody good. The achievement they've pulled off on it is great. It's insane. And the thing is, you have to remember, whatever you're watching, whether you're disappointed, completely on side with, or indifferent, you're watching something that's like a film on TV.
Yeah.
You know, the fact that all of these seasons you've had... Usually the acting quality and stuff. Yeah, there's been a little bit staring into each other's eyes this season because it was a little bit kind of sped up. But you've had like movie level costumes, settings, shots, plots. It's kind of like every film wishes it had enough time to build up the characters. Because you think like a film, like the longest film I've probably ever seen has been about... what, 4 hours long, maybe?
Yeah.
And 4 hours long is like, what, 4 episodes of Game of Thrones? To have like years and years to build up all of these characters and plots and worlds and all that sort of stuff to then you know, have the final act, because essentially this whole season is the final act in the film. I gotta take my hat off. I do think the writers should have spent a bit more time, but that's my personal opinion. But from a objective opinion, I think it's an astounding achievement.
It was a victim of its own success, really.
Yeah.
It was so popular, but they got to do it all. They got to kind of get to an ending, even if it isn't the ending. They were under advisement by George R. R. Martin, so I think that's kind of where the books are supposed to end up. But, you know, they kind of did it. It would have just been too difficult, I think, for them to kind of deliver... You know,
the thing is,
you try and deliver the same sort of thing when they didn't have anything to base it on.
Yeah, the problem, yeah, that's the thing. It's like, if there was more material, if he had written some shorthand bits like guidance notes or anything and steered them, if George R. R. Martin came back and said, you know what, I'm going to be more than just a special executive producer or whatever, I'll help you guys out to figure this ending out, then fuck yeah, he should have done that. You know, instead of writing completely different book series. There's been all sorts of news going on, and some of it might be true, some of it might be bollocks. It's all about hearsay and clickbait all over the internet, whether HBO would have given them more money. But then the actors apparently were burnt out by this point, because they were filming it so fast and their schedules are so crazy. You know, George R. R. Martin's gone on in some informal interviews at Comic-Con saying he wanted it to be a 13-episode season, or 13 seasons of Game of Thrones. By the end of the day, he didn't approach HBO and he didn't work with them.
No.
So all of that is subject, and that's the thing. That's why I'm looking at this with eyes unclouded by hate, as they say. And I'm just sort of going, you know what? It is what it is. He didn't wake up and Ned Stark didn't go, oh, I've just had a fucking awful dream. You know? And I think it's just the way it ended. And it was spectacular. And it was like, God, after all that, it's almost like a bit sad. It's like almost like a bittersweet ending.
Again, another ending. But it's a show that we've been talking about pretty much for the whole length of this podcast.
Exactly.
So it has to be in there.
End of an era.
That's it. Absolutely. What you got next?
Next, I have Stranger Things.
Yay.
Which we were talking about briefly earlier. Fantastic show, I got to say. It was the first time it made me think. Having recollections about the first season... there were so many bits where I was like going, oh shit, there's no mobiles.
yeah.
There's no... I'm like, stop talking, stop touching this thing. I'm thinking, forensic science wasn't up to date then. So the idea of people touching bodies and all that sort of stuff, normally nowadays you've got to be careful because like DNA and all that sort of thing. And it's like, back then it was like, oh, someone's dead. I'm going to go touch them and see if they're all right. Everything was different. And it was just like, you know, the kids on the bikes. I was like, yeah, I remember when we were all out on bikes and walkie-talkies and all that sort of stuff. But we never really had walkie-talkies. But people did. You know, I remember a lot of my other friends did and stuff. And it just felt like that was the way it was. And I see sort of like, you know, bike kids now and they're like hoodies and stuff. And they're kind of emulating that. It's kind of going back to that. But I just loved the way that it built this world up. And the fact that the mum, Renona Wilder's character, was so crazy. And Hopper was just like, oh, this is a cop. He's a kind of sleepy town cop. We're used to them being lazy. Hang on, what? He's just gone and jumped straight into the middle of this thing. And it completely threw us. Because it funny enough, to use a pun, it literally turned everything upside down.
Absolutely, well done, bravo.
Yeah. And I just thought it was such a good season. And by the time that season ended, we all knew we were on to something special. And second season, might have had a couple of blips, but it was all just telling more of the story. And now this third season's like, wow. And we know there's got to be a fourth. It can't end like that. Especially now Netflix have basically bought studios in America and in Britain now. They bought Shepperton.
That's right.
So they're clearly, I mean, they've got more room now to either build sets that are supposed to be in different locations or whatever. You know, you can build a street corner that's supposed to be set in London for a scene or whatever in a big studio. You've got, they've got money and they're not afraid. And I think the fact that they're going to lose the Marvel license, it's probably going to be a bonus for them because they're not going to be paying out for that. That money's going to funnel straight back in because I'm sure that's not cheap.
Yeah, that's very true.
And the
true.
Fact that they've been working with a lot of Hollywood actors. I mean, for me, the biggest shock was you had... Oh, what was it? I think you had... what's her name? Emma Watson in something. And then you had Will Smith with Bright, which wasn't that great a film. But the fact that you had a Will Smith film that was on Netflix first... That's insane.
Oh, yeah.
That is insane. You know, Will Smith turns around and goes, oh, I'm going to make a new film. What's this? What's it got? It's not in the cinema. It's going to be on a streaming platform.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, what? And they've done loads since. You know, Sandra Bullock, Bird Box. And you had just loads since. And people seem to be wanting to use this new avenue of telling stories and films. You know, it's just brilliant. I love it.
Yeah, I'm just looking to, I'm wondering, yeah, this show is only just a little bit younger than Netflix in the UK, because I thought that was kind of it, because that Netflix has pretty much fueled this show since its beginning.
Oh, yeah, it's the biggest, I think it's the biggest thing, that the biggest pull that they've had. It's the premium thing. It is. You need Netflix to see Stranger Things.
Yeah. Oh yeah, big time. Yeah. So talking about a show that has kind of been, you know, on part of a platform that has grown as the show has carried on. I need to mention finally the show that sort of started it, and that was Breaking Bad. And it only just about counts because it ended in the second episode of this podcast. We were discussing the finale of Breaking Bad. So I've just been sort of furiously checking that it actually was still valid, because I was looking down the list of episodes and there just isn't really any Breaking Bad there. And that's because it was in it. The whole thing has been in the shadow of its conclusion.
It's ended, yeah.
But, you know, we've had Better Call Saul since.
Yeah,
and
this upcoming Breaking Bad. Was it What Jesse Did Next?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, Bryan Cranston and Aaron Paul have been sort of teasing something. So I think Walter's going to be part of it as well. So, but I don't know if it's just that. I think there's, because Better Call Saul, the fifth season of that, has been delayed. For some reason, they're saying that they're just waiting for talent availability, which probably means
he's probably just doing a little cameo in it.
Well, no, I think it's probably they're just waiting for all of the actors that they've got in that to be free to do it, because they've actually pulled together quite a lot of the old cast. You know, Gus is in there now,
oh, brilliant,
Mike, yeah, it's. It's really good. It's worth catching up on.
Yeah, I need to watch that. I kept putting it off for some reason because I wasn't sure about it. But you guys were I remember you guys were raving about it for ages.
Yeah, it's probably a lot better to watch like and binge with it all being there, because there's like four seasons of it, I think, now.
Oh, dear.
So it's well worth checking out. It's as good as quality as Breaking Bad ever was.
Cool.
Just slightly different setup with different characters. But yeah, I have to mention Breaking Bad and its legacy. Because, if it weren't for Breaking Bad, I don't think I ever would have started doing this, to be quite honest. It was all the fuel I needed to start podcasting, pretty much. What have you got? Have you got any more? Oh, you have got more. You told me you've got more.
Yeah, I do. To be honest, there are two shows on here that I don't know what I'm going to go with. To be honest, I've got to go with Cobra Kai. I've not seen the second season.
Okay.
But the first season of that, for something to come back based on the Karate Kid, and actually be fun, really enjoyable, and I really need to watch the second season of it, but I think we just haven't had time because we know we're going to binge it.
It's there. It won't take you long once you get round to it.
I really liked it. I really liked the story that it was Johnny Lawrence. And
the switch around.
Yeah. It was almost like the joke from How I Met Your Mother with Barney. You know, Neil Patrick Harris's character. He goes, the real story of the Karate Kid is about Johnny and then how Ralph Macchio came and basically ruined his life. And that was the perspective that it comes from.
Yeah.
And I just thought that was awesome. It's brilliant. It was like, oh, following him. And Ralph Macchio is like, you know, playing off his cheesy, I was all interstate champion, I sell cars. And all of his things are like karate based and all that. And, you know, and he's got his daughter who isn't that fussed. And then at the end she gets in. And it's just, yeah, I really need to watch it now, remembering what happened and stuff. And I just love the fact that he reforms Cobra Kai. And it's like, yeah, it's fun. It's good. It reminds me of another one on my list as well.
Yeah, no, it's got a good way of sort of recreating that coming of age thing, but with familiar characters that are now older.
It's made me want to actually go back and watch the films again. I know they're a product of their time, but it's like that feeling. It's almost like how the first Creed film made me want to go and watch the pivotal Rocky films again.
Right.
It's that sort of like, this is more of the world, and I like it. I like the feel that it's given me. I like the fun. When I finished watching that season, I was like, "Oh, that was good. That was really good." I wasn't expecting much, but that was great. Cobra Kai, definitely recommend it. I need to go watch it.
Right, you got any honourable mentions you want to mention before we finish?
Glow.
Yeah.
Because that also reminded me a bit like Cobra Kai, sort of like a nice product of its time, the 80s and stuff. Chilling Adventures of Sabrina. Surprising show.
Not seen that yet.
No. Just the way they did it, like a really fucked up, dark version of Sabrina, the Teenage Witch. You know, it's quite nice to see a really twisted, you know, they're all like talking about the Dark Lord, and it's literally this goat-headed, it's Satan. It's goat-headed demon, and you see him. And it's just nice seeing, what's her name, off Doctor Who and stuff. Oh, God, I can't remember her name. She's a British actor.
What, the new Doctor Who?
Eric Roberts.
Oh.
Michelle Gomez. That's it, sorry.
Michelle Gomez.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
You know, she was really great in that. She's been really good in this role as well. I won't spoil what she does, but she's really good in this. But yeah, it was really cool. I just liked it. It was nice seeing like different versions of the characters, and everything's a bit fucked up. Like little things like, instead of saying, oh, you know, thank God, it's like, oh, thank Satan. And literally, they're not even shying away from it. It's just like crazy.
Yeah, she looks a bit demonic. Yeah. I can imagine her being quite good in a show like that.
It's pretty cool.
Cool.
Scream, the TV series, came out ages ago. But we watched it all in one sitting, and it was really good.
Cool.
As TV series go, it was really good. Good Omens.
Yeah.
Been waiting for that for ages. I loved it. It kind of divided some people, but then I think I don't really know why, because if you know Terry Pratchett's writing, it was spot on. Terry Pratchett is very similar to kind of... a lot of people are probably going to find me and burn me for saying this, but it's the kind of British humour that's very similar in tone to the Grant Naylor books, like Hitchhiker and stuff like that.
It's similar, it's a very similar style. It's wacky stuff.
But the darkness comes from, obviously Pratchett's got a bit of darkness in him as well, but the darkness from Neil Gaiman in there as well. So the kind of fucked up, messed up things that kind of look like American Gods and stuff and everything else.
Yeah.
So it was very much, it felt like it was both of them in there. and I just thought it was so good. Yeah. And there were some shots, and they said themselves that there was like bits of both of them in the characters of Azithrael, whatever his name was, and Crowley. And when you see shots of them together, where Neil Gaiman's wearing all black and Terry Pratchett's wearing all white, you kind of go, oh, yeah. I loved it. I thought it was really, really good, really charming, and I'm so glad they finally got it made. And there isn't going to be a follow-up to it, I don't think, because I don't think there's any follow-up books to it. But I just hope that it means that Amazon are going to do more Neil Gaiman adaptations, and then we get to see Neverwhere, because Neverwhere, I think, will be amazing.
Yeah, I think they must get to it finally, because they're doing Sandman at Netflix, so... Yeah, they'll get there.
I'm glad he's finally getting some dues, because writes some really good stuff.
Yeah, it's quality stuff. Man, if they're making a show of The Witcher, then they're going to make everything by Neil Gaiman.
You can't ignore The Witcher.
No. It might be shit. I'm really excited, but
I've seen some people questioning like the armor and stuff like that. I think in a post-Game of Thrones world, where the costumes have been insane.
That's it. That's the standard.
That's the problem
now.
It's not really a standard. It's like they went at it with movie level Lord of the Rings. Oh, we've invented a whole new type of armor because these characters look like they were based on Eastern. Like you can't do that for a TV show, but they did.
You certainly can't. So, do you have any more?
I think that was Scream, Chilling Adventures, and. Only because I've been watching it since the dawn of time and it's finishing, and Supernatural.
Oh, okay. Fine.
I left it to the end so you could get it out of the way.
Okay, that's fine. Cool. All right then. So I know you don't have to work tomorrow, but I do. So I'm going to have to call time now. That's probably the longest recording session we've ever done.
Probably is, mate. All right. Well, I'll get these to you.
Hang on. Before we end, I just want to make a quick disclaimer here. I mentioned earlier we've got the end of Star Wars coming up, and we've had to witness the end of Game of Thrones and the end of like this phase of the MCU. And yeah, this is kind of all part and parcel with the way I want to approach the show. There's as much as there is uncertainty about all these franchises that are very beloved to us. I feel like I can't even. I mean, I generally a bit behind the curtain here. I plan these episodes ahead and the recording schedule I plan around major releases. Now, looking at the next year or so, there isn't the same amount of like Marvel points in the calendar or, you know, episodes, you know, seasons of Game of Thrones and stuff that I would usually use as like, you know, recording every month or whatever. And so also, I feel like, we're a little bit watching different things a lot, and there's just us two really doing it now. So I've decided that I think it's time to sort of, I'm not like, we're not ending the show, but I want to basically, I thought episode 200 will be the time when I will take the numbers off the episodes and the regularity of the podcast, you know, ever since I started, was told that podcasting was a thing that you had to do regularly to build an audience. Oh. I'm not kidding myself. I think we've built the audience we've built, and we're very grateful to everyone that listens, as you know, the few of you that do. We still enjoy doing this because we just enjoy having the conversation, and it gives us a chance to have this conversation when we do. And I sometimes find the longer we leave it, the more we have to talk about and the more we have to get off our chests, and it's probably better for it. So yeah, going forwards, the schedule's going to be a little bit less. I'm thinking roughly we're going to be doing like seasonal episodes, or seasonal recording at least. So, you know, like I sort of had roughly in my head, you know, we'll probably come do something around Oscar time. We'll probably do something at the end of each year to discuss like our movies and TV of the year. I'd like to continue doing the summer movie wager. Yep. Obviously, summer is a time when lots of movies come out, so I'd like to still do some stuff then. And the thing is, as well, if like we end up recording like we have tonight for 2.5 hours, then that might end up you might end up with more episodes than just one, you know, four a year.
Exactly.
I imagine there will be more than that. So, we're just going to kind of take it as it comes, but it's going to be more about like the shit that's going on rather than us having to turn up and do an episode because we've got to put something out because it's, you know, the week that episode 201 has to come out.
Yeah.
So, yeah,
Also, if something happens, like movie-wise or something like that, like an event or a movie is just too damn big, we may do an ad hoc recording, I think.
Yeah, or if there's like a major news announcement, like, I don't know.
Marvel's decided they're teaming up with DC and doing a Marvel versus DC.
Yeah, some earth-shattering amount of news that will just
DC
be...
Will DC actually make a good film? Sorry, no. Oh.
Yeah, well, you know, that could happen. Who knows? Well, I heard good things about Aquaman, but that's a whole other conversation. If there was like an earth-shattering news story that we obviously aren't going to wait like until Christmas to talk about, then yeah, we'll probably do a little emergency podcast when we can organise it. So, that's the future of the Not Watching podcast. I hope you've enjoyed this best of highlights of the last of the whole thing. And, I think that's all I've got to say.
I've got to say, coming from sort of like the MovieCon podcast from days, years ago, it's been fun so far. I've loved it. Things may change, but, you know, we've still got a lot to say.
That's it. I still like doing it. I still look forward to doing it. I still like chronicling our musings on all the things we've seen. And, cool.
Time may come, time may go, but we'll still be not watching.
Very nice. Thanks for listening to the Not Watching Podcast, part of the Not Listening Podcast Network, where you can also find the Not Playing Podcast, where we talk about video games, and the Not Listening Podcast, where you can hear Adam and Co. talk about all kinds of nonsensical nonsense. You can email us at notwatchingpodcast@gmail.com, or you can tweet at or follow us on Twitter at notwatchingpod. You can find the show notes for all our shows at notlistening.co.uk, and if you like what you've heard here, please do leave us a review. Anyway, that's all for now. Until next time, bye!